All right, good evening everyone, and thanks to all those who have joined online. So welcome to the 15th episode of this Silver Jubilee Talks. We have been doing this as, so just to check if people online can hear us, if somebody would confirm. Right, okay. Alright, we'll try to fix that. Just give us a moment. Is it better?
Yes, it is better.
Okay, great. Great, thanks. So we'll get started. Welcome again. This is the 15th episode, and in this we'll also focus on our 15th batch. So as we have sort of, this is part of the ritual is to sort of talk about what this Silver Jubilee Talks is. And, and then of course we'll also have a brief about the department so that people who are new or people who are joining batch-wise would know where we are, where we stand in the last 25 years. So we plan to conduct 25 of these events, and the objective is to invite four design experts, two typically from practice, two from research or academia, and then we talk about design. And by the end of it, 25 events, we'll have spoken to 100 experts, and then we also plan to publish it out as a book, as a coffee table book, what the designers have talked about in terms of the design discipline and their own journeys and so on. Today's we will introduce the speakers as we go along, in each of these events we invite at least one batch at a time. So the first event, first batch, so that's how the 15th batch is. Some of you have joined, and that's great to see. Sorry for the very late invitation to you all. All right, so what I'll do is, at this point in time, I usually invite Professor Chakravarti to come and give a brief introduction about the department, but he's currently traveling, and so is Professor Adibhaka Sen. He'll come and join a bit late, he has some work. So I'm going to give the introduction to the department itself and its history. And this is also for people who invite our speakers to sort of know about the department. So the department was established in 1998. Though the program, the M.Des Programme, started a year before. So we started with what was then CED department. CEDT and Mechanical came together to offer the program. And we eventually formed the department in 1998. And since then, it has been housed in what we now know as the CPDM building. The building itself is undergoing transformation. We have been midway through it for a very long time. We potentially will be midway, in this state for about another year and a half. But by the end of it, one would expect a building like this, which should sort of give us the right amount of space and the right kind of communication of what the design department should be like. During these 25 years, we have also done reasonably well in terms of the growth of the department. So for a department which is 25 year old, we are already amongst top three purely based on design in India. But if you include, of course, design research, then we stand apart. And if you just look at the citation patterns and things like that, we could be considered to be number one in Asia in terms of research in design and ninth in the world. During these years, we are a small department in terms of the number of people that we graduate. So our M.Des program, typically, we started with 8 people per batch. Now we sometimes take up to 20, 25. But on an average, you can see that in 25 years, we have produced 415 design graduates. So it's a small number, but even with that number, we have produced a decent amount of patents. We also have 65 PhD research graduates already, and we currently have about 65 people doing PhD or research. We have a number of awards coming along, both for students and faculty. See some of that. About 3-4 years ago, or 5 years ago, we started the M.Tech program. We have graduated 2 batches. And again, from the number itself, you can see that our batches are fairly small. So in 2 batches, we have produced 18 people as graduates from the M.Tech program. That's the M.Tech in Smart Manufacturing. Here is a snapshot of some of the awards that our students have won, including the more recent Red Dot Award, Apoorv and Yoganch. And previously we had others who have won Red Dot Award, mentioned in Times Magazine for amongst the best inventions, James Dyson Award, and so on, right? So we have done fairly good, and we are proud of our alumni for what they have achieved within this period of time. Besides, of course, the awards, we also have award-winning startups, and Nitin is there, and Stan will ask, you know, at some point he'll talk about himself when we hear from the alumni. And similarly, we have Grass Bionics and other startups that have come more recently. We again see in the recent awards, you'll see one of our startup coming from CPDM, which is making some waves in this domain. So in the recent news, so we also talk about what has happened recently. So in the last 1 month or 2 months, we had the IISc conference, which was in France, in which Anubhav and Prasthi Chakravarti's paper got one of the reviewers' favorite award. So that's the best paper award. More recently, as I said, Dr. Hemant Jayant, he received first prize in the competition on robotics in manufacturing, and he did his PhD here with Dr. Manish Arora, and now his startup is doing an interesting work in the area of additive manufacturing. We also, in the last 3-4 years, we started this idea of having adjunct faculty and also mentors of practice. And one of our adjunct faculty is Dr. Nagahuman Anumaiya, and he's the director of CMTI, and he was recently inducted as a fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering. So, as we've said, we have a strong research program. So these are research graduates, many of them placed in different positions as faculty. I'm not going to list them, but you can see that they are spread wide in India and overseas as well. So our span in research influence in India and overseas is growing at its own pace and fairly good for the numbers that we have. I'm not going to talk about much on the vision. It's fairly clear that we are focused on systemic solutions, systematic approach to design, and that is stated in our vision as well. How do we address systematic issues, complex issues that need to be addressed in the society, and make an impact and develop solutions that are socially impactful. The focus and the mission has been on developing competent professionals. We hope that students look for leadership roles and influence the practice, innovate for the society. And of course, with the rest of the IISc, we focus more on knowledge and methods and tools and how that impacts the practice. Here are some landmarks. We have 11 core faculty, 7 associate faculty, 30 plus participating faculty, which means a number of faculty members contribute to the program here. And then number of firsts, starting from the first PhD program, first smart factory, and so on. This number has to change. I think it's 25 batches already. So I have to update that number. We have 10 research labs, those things are growing. 4 major initiatives over this period. So this now we have the National Design Innovation Network, which is one of the 5 that's there. There's a special focus on medtech in the department with the CPDM Med and Technology Business Incubator in the area of medtech and geriatric healthcare. The CEFC Smart Factory has been a significant sort of infrastructure which has created the smart manufacturing program. And then we have the Design Innovation Center. So a number of major initiatives there. 2 major conference series that we run. One is the ICOD, which happens every 2 years, and then the iForum again, which happens every 2 years, and these run in alternative years. So one year it's ICOD, the other it's iForum. And with that, we come to the agenda for today. You've all seen it. So I've already given the brief of CPDM. We'll now move into our first phase, which is the 10-minute talk from each of the panelists. And here are our panelists for today. So this is not necessarily in the order in which I'm going to ask the panelists to sort of talk. To make it easier, given that this is a hybrid event, we always ask our online panelists to first start with their 10-minute talk, and then we'll ask the people here to then take over. So Seema, if I can ask you to sort of please come on camera and give your talk. And while you set yourself up, I'll quickly read out your bio to introduce you to the audience.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes. just let me give me a minute. I'll set up my screen here. So Seema is currently an assistant professor at the Department of Design, IIT Hyderabad, and a PhD scholar at IDC, IIT Bombay. She has more than a decade of experience as a visual communicator, documentary photographer, and design faculty. She has worked for various governmental and non-governmental organizations as a designer. Earlier, she worked with the DG Academy of Design, Kerala State Institute of Design, and National Institute of Design as an academic. She was instrumental in setting up and starting activities at the Kerala State Institute of Design. Her design interests are with multimodal visual storytelling, using data visualization, information design, and interaction designs. So I'll go, Seema.
Yeah. Hi. Yeah. Thank you, Vishal, for the generous introduction. Can you see my screen?
We see a white blank, unless that's the screen.
White blank?
Yeah, it's so I don't see, we don't see anything on the screen other than a white.
I do have problem sharing, I suppose. Just a moment.
Sure. Take your time.
Is there someone else sharing the screen? I'm seeing Uttam's.
Okay, no, it should not be.
Should not be, okay. Just a moment, I'm leaving and I'll come back.
Sure. Right. Okay. Yeah, we can see you now.
Okay. Can you see the screen right now?
Yes. Yeah, please go ahead. Thanks.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you, everybody at CPDM. I would like to kind of say hi to the new batch, and let me introduce once more. I am Seema, an assistant professor at the Department of Design at IIT Hyderabad. Here I'll share a very brief idea about what I've been up to, and I've given the title Many Forms of Data Points. Here is in a nutshell. Now I think I can confidently claim that I have spent more than a decade as an academic in various design schools of the country. Areas of interest broadly comes under communication design and HCI, but specific academic interests are in data and information visualization for various domains, and interactive data narratives, which you will predominantly find in online journalism and online instructional design. When I started my career in early 2000s, platforms to support design activities were very low in my part of the geography. So some of the first jobs were to kind of set up platforms that would support design activities, such as one of them was Startup Studio by fresh visual design graduates. And the second one was a design school under the state government of Kerala. Quite a bit of new media communication design work, but after working for some time in communication design, and specifically new media was my domain at that time, 2003-2004. Around 2007-2008, I was bitten by photography bug and took up part-time documentary photography, mainly because of the disconnect I was beginning to feel with the routine visual design briefs. So now I would like to tell a few stories from some of the documentary photography. So this was also an attempt to kind of understand the space we are working as designers, understanding the complex connections of the country a little better. And at some point, I also developed an interest to kind of communicate the insights from the other side. So this was one of the story, and I named it Land of Lost Reflections. And this is from the backwater area of Kerala, Alappi, and that specific place is called Kuttanad. So this is a series of photographs that later becomes, you know, part of many other publications. So this particular story is about plenty of water around, but not really a drop to actually drink. Due to various reasons, ranging from an unconventional agricultural practice, which is carried out below mean sea level. And this is also one of the most climate change vulnerable regions of Kerala. So this is the sequence of photographs usually publications would ask for. There is a narrative, there is a sequence, there is a way of telling stories. But as someone who got interested in data, you know, around the same time, I would also sometimes try to kind of visualize and find patterns through photography. So I'll take one aspect and then that sort of repeats. So in this particular case, you can see this is the front porch of most of the houses. They will have a little area where they can fetch water. And you're basically seeing more layers of information than you see in this format. There are some of them very well kept and some of them not kept. The water quality, of course, it is in a bad shape. So this is usually called photo vis in data visualization terms. It is dense in details and it leads with some more insights about financial conditions and effort of the family and many other things. So now coming to another story, which I call as Freebidam, from the stories from the heartland of Tamil Nadu. So some of these topics actually comes from my interest also in design. Cost to many other aspects of social life. So now in this particular case, the topic is about products and services and how some of them become an interesting mechanism to woo voters in the politics. So they range from simple bags, saris, to gas connections, but you start looking at the details, some interesting stories start to emerge. So if you're aware of Tamil politics, I don't know how many of you know, the mixies were actually given by AIDMK, which I mean by the Jayalalitha's time in around 2007-2008, all those times. So, but you would find there are some of these pictures on the left. You can see one in which it's a mixie. Would still get the mixie, but then, you know, he would paste the stickers of the opposition party. Very similar way, you can see another picture. The fan comes from Jayalalitha, but there is a sticker of Karunanidhi on the middle. And there is also a story here. You get a free laptop, and this is a scene of somebody selling a laptop for money. So this is, again, I have arranged it in the photo vis manner so that you get more layers of information. Some more interesting content. This was called the particular skirt, the lower skirt that you're seeing with women are called kabaya. This is has very strong Portuguese connection. So they're all in a way descendants of Portuguese colonization in India. And what you're seeing is, you know, a particular group of women who are about 75 years old. If you look, you know, none of them really exist right now. There's a story which was done in 2013. The idea of putting these things together was to kind of give the idea of the age and, you know, how they wear the dress and the historical connection with this particular cloth piece, which is only made in Chennai. And you can see another variation of the what we call as munda in black color here. So this is again another story. So this is the group of people which was finally existing some years before this particular story was happening. I think nobody may be alive right now. So overall, the attempt was to kind of escape the numbers and give it a humanistic face. So this is one method we use in classrooms to kind of sensitize on the human value of data in our classes. So here it is a set of photographs of 4 months of Occupy Wall Street, which happened in 2011. But the idea was to kind of look at the signboards each of them are carrying and the kind of people, you know, that they belong to. Some of these things got published, exhibited, all of that has happened. But now, coming back to the academics, how do we teach data visualization? How are we going to attempt other forms of data visualization was one of the things I was interested in. So other things also include things like data crunching and curation of information, simplifying very complex topics to a single page without losing the essence, and which is called an infographic. So these are some of the work students have done, attempted in class. But the main interesting point is to bring in Indian content, some complex Indian content. For example, this was a story I was also amused by. One of the students from Nagaland attempted this story, and he actually was talking about the Battle of Kohima in 1944, when Japanese assaulted the Indian British Indian side, and through a very rough terrain of geography. So he actually gave this very beautiful infographic of how this happened and how Japanese came into the British India. So this was something, a surprise that came during the class. Another one is about the coins from 1850s to the current one. You can see the sizes of the coin changing, the material of the coin changing, etc., through this particular timeline that one of the students created. So this is very dense information that is put together to kind of convey information in 5 minutes, to read within 5 minutes. Other interesting topic from India, for example, if you look at Jharkhand, and very, you start closely looking at the data that you will find, most of the governments which came in Jharkhand after the partition between Bihar and Jharkhand, many of them haven't really, you know, went about 2 years or 3 years. This was the maximum amount of time they have spent in the government. So now from here, the task was that, you know, most of the, again, what we were doing was one-sided passive communication of data. The challenge was to kind of, how do we create more engaging data forms? So I was sort of inspired by Georgia Lupi and Stefani Prasavik, two interesting women who created this interesting project called Dear Data. So based on which students collect their own data and engage with their own behaviors. So this was one method. A lot of handmade data cards are made, something like these. And but again, there are, you know, we wanted to challenge ourselves. So a second method was to kind of create more participatory, large-scale platforms where there is more active engagement and learning for both the creators and participants. So while many of these data collection is possible to kind of do digitally, but the challenge was to kind of make the physical environments where audience can come in freely and then participate with it. So students become the designers of the platform, just like Instagram and Facebook become the holders of several form of information, and see how data grows in real situation. So most of them are experiments. Data may not be accurate, but creating them was exciting for majority of the students. So the other challenge was also to kind of, you know, take up some complex topics. So many of the students had inhibition of taking up such topics, unlike social science schools, IITs generally consider talking these topics publicly as a very taboo subject. So it was very interesting to see some of them coming out of the hesitation and, you know, creating these interesting participatory data visualizations. This was another one which is talking about, have you felt discrimination in the campus? This was also after some of the suicide attempts that happened in the campus. So we got very interesting data. Students attempted, and many of them came, though discreetly and, definitely participated to kind of tell that they were discriminated in the campus. Another one is about, how would you choose color? How do you choose the color and associate it politically? So this was a very interesting participatory data visualization where students created this very elaborate voting systems. They also face some real life situations where on the right side, you can see on one of the ballot boxes, somebody's picked it at night and the campus. So while most of them sort of lean towards the quantitative form of data collection, there are also some experiments with qualitative data. So they also learn in the process that data collection can be gamified, it can be part of exhibitions or social change platforms, among many other applications. I would just like to wrap up the session with the final thing that we're beginning to do is to kind of create a student-led data narrative portal, which is going to be interactive in format on climate and environment-related stories from their own region. So all these students are coming from various parts and we want them to kind of pick topics and then come back and engage. Some of these aspects a little more closely, just like the earlier photo was that so that's it basically. So the idea was to kind of give you a variety of things that we do with data in the campus. Hope you got some information from this. Thank you for listening.
Hey, thank you, Seema. Thanks. That was wonderful. I will park the questions for the end. We'll go through all the panelists and then we'll go through the panel discussion and then we'll take. So sure. Anyone has questions, please mark it so that we come back to the questions later. And just to sort of, there were occasional breaks. I think internet is playing its part. So I just wanted to let you know that, there were some pauses where we lost you for a couple of seconds or so.
Oh, okay.
But, the story was so well told that it didn't really sort of affect the storytelling. So kudos to you. Rajesh, if we can have your talk now.
Hello, Vishal, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Just give me a minute.
Yeah, before you start, Rajesh, I have to sort of introduce you. Just give me a minute to open your profile. And it's easy to introduce you as our alumni, but I'll try to, give a little more. So Rajesh Kumar Gogu is an alumni of CPDM, M.Des 2003 batch. From the time he left the campus till today, he has been working with Maruti Suzuki design team. Over the last 20 years, he has designed more than 20 cars, including Breza, first and second generation, Alto K10, Fronx, and Ford concept cars. He was awarded the Young Achiever of the Year in 2008 by Auto Monitor. Currently, he is heading the exterior and advanced design at Maruti Suzuki. He and his wife, Christy, also from CPDM, live in Delhi with their two daughters, Zora and Ira. I hope I pronounced them correctly. And of course, they were my immediate seniors. So yeah, great to see you, Rajesh.
Good to see you, Vishal. Okay, let me share my screen. And I hope you can see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you, Vishal, for that introduction. It's always good to be back at CPDM because it brings lots of memories, good memories, of course. And hopefully one day I would be able to come in flesh and interact with all of you guys. I'm looking forward for that day. So without any delay, let me start. As introduced, I'm Rajesh Kumar Gogu. I've been working in Maruti Suzuki for the last 20 years, and I currently take care of exterior and advanced design in Maruti. So today I'm going to talk about leadership in SUV through design, how we intended to become leaders in SUV segment as well, majorly targeting through design. So if you know about automotive industry, automotive industry is rapidly growing in India. And in fact, by 2030, the estimate is that there will be market for 6 million vehicles, out of which probably half of it would be SUV segment. As you can see, the market projection in 2018 to 19, there were hardly 3 lakh vehicles, SUVs were sold in India. But if you see 20 to 26, the projection would be 2.2 million vehicles will be sold. And by 2030, it's very safe to say 3 million SUVs will be sold. So being market leader in India, we almost hold 40 to 45% of market share. It's important for us to capture SUV segment as well. So this project is very critical to achieve that goal for our organization. So if you look at within Maruti, we have a lineup of SUVs. To start with, Grand Vitara, which we recently launched, and the target customer for this is a premium, sophisticated customer. And Grand Vitara is exceptionally well received, and it is catering to that premium segment. And also we have XL6. Basically, it is intended for practical and comfort seeking because of captain seats or whatever legroom you got there. So XL6 caters to that practical comfort seeking customer. And of course, we have Brezza. It is for people who wants to show their personality, especially their boldness or confidence. And Brezza is there. It's for them. And I'm extremely proud. And it sells almost more than 15,000 vehicles every month. And from the day we launched in 2016, over 9 lakh vehicles were sold. That's quite an achievement. We did through Brezza. And we have two lifestyle SUVs, and one is Jimny, and you all know Jimny. Sorry about the image. It was a old presentation. I didn't have time to change it. And of course, today I'm going to talk about and next new shape, Franz, right? So let me begin. Whenever we start any project, the management asks us before even we start sketching how this vehicle would be different from the rest of the vehicles we have within our portfolio, because we have lots of cars within our portfolio. So in advance research time, what we did was we plotted all the profiles that are available for us. Okay. So if you look at red line, it's a Grand Vitara, and the green line Brezza, and XL6, and then Jimny. So if you see Jimny as the most authentic SUV, the rear glass is upright, almost 90 degree. So if you plot the A pillar angle and the rear glass both together, the touching point, vanishing point, basically the top of the triangle leans towards the rear passenger. So similarly, you can see the different profiles. So the way we try to explain our management is we can come up with a new shape by bringing that point, top of the triangle, forward. So we can create a vehicle which is like leaning forward, having a very athletic stance, but in sitting quite low. So this is how we told our management that we can create a different shape within our lineup. And next, we quickly made a very rough sketch. So in this rough sketch, we defined the shape for a new car. So what we wanted to achieve is an upright front, and also a very high rear tailgate in terms of where the lamps are sitting. And then very dynamic line, a cab forward stance, but a very dynamic roof line. So these are the three ingredients we wanted to have this car, because that's what we showed in the previous advanced study. Then we immediately made we call it a proportion study model. It's not intended for design, but it's just to check the proportions of the car, whether what we were telling management can actually be perceived as we are explaining to them. So it is a very important step in advanced research stage to show management, because they cannot visualize things even though a fantastic sketch can be made, but they cannot understand. So we made this proportion model, and this proportion model was kept next to some of our SUVs, and we told our management that we can create a new shape, a new SUV. And they basically, we built the confidence and we got their approval, and the project was kicked. Project started. Okay, and that's how France project came into existence. So all this happened during the advanced research stage. So in Maruti, we have we spent time doing advanced research and convincing our management about the future prospects. So then the project began. Then who is the customer? And again, our planning and our research team did research, and then they defined the user. It's basically the concept for this product concept was this modern and dynamic progressive SUV. And the user, we wanted to cater to a user who is attention seeking, who wants to stand out, who wants a shape that is unconventional. And that's a user, and we started with, and then we, like most of you in CPDM, we are very keen on this. What are we going to achieve through this? So the design objectives are very clear from beginning. For all the designers, they keep these objectives in mind when they make sketches. So we want a very clear expression of something new, a dynamic and aerodynamic silhouette, a profile we wanted. And also we want a strong visual CG, because the car is going to be quite low. It's not like a conventional SUV, but we want all the volumes and all the placement of elements to be slightly higher, so that visual CG would be high, which would give SUV strength. And the front and rear, we wanted to have very strong down-road graphics. And also we have already some SUVs in Nexa brand, and which are, you already saw one, and some are going to come. So, but we want to have a common thread connecting all the Nexa products. So that also we had to keep in mind that while designing. And of course, strengthening the SUV, MSL SUV lineup, and creating something exciting and new. So these were the object on, this was the design theme board. Basically, we wanted to have a product that is high on tension, high on dynamism, and there should be some strong contrast. Even in a surface, there should be light and shadow. There should be, in terms of graphics and in terms of volume, there should be strong contrast. Overall, we wanted to create a very sensuous, very different from Brezza, which is like very boxy and muscle, raw muscles. But we want something sensuous in this car. So these were the initial sketches that were made. In fact, three studios competed for this project, and these were some of the shortlisted sketches we presented to our management, and then we shortlisted four, and these were the scale models we made from those shortlisted options. As you can see, the scale models are pretty detailed, and the objectives we set in the beginning were maintained, high hood line, high rear tailgate line, and as well as the very dynamic roof profile. So we presented these options, and this was the scale model that impressed everyone. And again, you can see Saurav from the right, third person, who is my boss, and who is also from CPDM. So I'd be very proud of what CPDM doing in MSIL. So this is the final design that was selected, and then I cannot show many of the images, but these are the few images. This is a clay model. The left side, the model you see, this is 1:1 clay model. In fact, in Maruti, we spend close to 4 to 5 months refining each and every line, each and every surface, each and every corner of the car on clay model. And then we scan and take it to the CAD, and then the class A will be done. But we heavily rely on clay models. So these are some snapshots of that clay model. And even you can see the protos of lamps and details taken care of from the beginning, okay? And also coming to sustainability is becoming a big topic and big issue. I mean, big factor wherever we go. In automotive industry, it's even more bigger issue, because we have to adhere to certain norms in order to sell our volumes. So for us, fuel economy becomes the most important factor. So so the aerodynamics, in a sense, plays a major role in terms of fuel economy. So in Maruti, we extensively do aero testing for our cars in CFD as well as in our actual wind tunnel. So for France, we faced lots of issues in terms of aerodynamics, because the team insisted on changing the design a lot in order to achieve the stringent targets we had in Maruti. But we stood our ground, especially the nose of the car. If you can see on the left-hand side, the top edge, you can see a bit of red. I hope you can see that. But anyway, that the aero team was not at all happy. They wanted that that area to be green, but we wanted that negative surface and in order to give an aggressive stance. So we hold on to it, but still we did certain refinements in order to achieve our targets, and we did meet aero targets. And this is the final clay model, our final CAD model, I would say. No, it's not clay, it's CAD shot. As you can see, upright front face here, and then rear lamps are sitting quite high, and the very strong dynamic roof line, and we nailed the brief that was given, and what we promised to the management, and we delivered very sensuous volumes as well. Yeah, and dynamic roof line. Yeah, overall, you can see two fender volumes. They are strong, but at the same time, they seamlessly merges into the main surfaces. So this is the final front ricotta. And as I said, Grand Vitara is there, which sits on the higher as a premium SUV. And France, in a sense, it's a lower than Vitara. But you can see the similarities between Grand Vitara and France in terms of the design language and the DNA. The grill, lamps, and all the elements, we took inspiration from Grand Vitara, but we made it more aggressive, more emotional in France, because it's a younger sibling of Grand Vitara. It had to have that kind of persona. So you can see how we achieved that. And that's the rear. And yeah, I think I'll quickly go through them. And coming to some of the details, we got inspired from the ice cubes. We wanted the three light dots. In fact, we want them to be like ice crystals. And when you see that, when you see the actual car and compare that with ice cubes, you can see how well we brought that connection between ice cubes or ice crystals and our lamps. And rear lamps, we wanted to be like sweeping high-tech neon lights. And that's what we achieved. And yeah, this is highly confidential, but I want you to see what design can do. The base vehicle we took was Baleno. And then we retain majority of the hard points of Baleno. I don't want to point out what all we kept, but look at the difference we created. Within the tight engineering constraints, each and every mm we move, engineering team would say, oh, you cannot do this. But still, the kind of emotional section we created on the side body and the emotional stance and the dynamics overall stance we created is like for us, it's quite an achievement. And this is the final shot. And here, a glimpse of the surfacing that was done on France. Yeah, that's all. Sorry, I overshot by 2 minutes. Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Raju. That was wonderful. And again, sir, as you know, contemporary of Rajesh at CPDM, I've seen him spend a lot of hours on sketching and his passion for car design. So it comes out. So again, Rajesh, I'll park the questions for the later session. So again, hold on to your questions. I'll now invite our next speaker, Dr. Ram Vivekananda, to come and give his talk. Lights, just give me a moment. Back for a moment. So Dr. Ram Vivekananda is a cognitive psychologist and a human-centered research strategist. He holds a PhD in psychology from the University of West Georgia, primarily focusing on consciousness. That was his PhD. The synthesis of phenomenology, cognitive psychology, intersections of brain sciences, AI, and design research distinctly shape his overarching mission and aspiration in his professional journey. He's an ardent proponent of the philosophy of infusing humanity into technology, product design, and development. Has previously helped launch healthcare products designed for special populations and has experience building educational products for massive open online courses. He currently works for Google Cloud as a UX researcher. He enjoys traveling, adventure sports, and nurturing his imagination through the art of dreaming. So looking forward to it.
Thank you, Dr. Vishal. Am I audible? Yeah, I wasn't going to present the slide, but it was hidden. But yeah, such impressive work by Rajesh and Seema. So first of all, it's a pleasure to be here, and it's an honor to be a part of the distinguished panel members. I'm a cognitive psychologist by background. I had the distinct pleasure to work with one of the renowned members who is working on the area of intuition, and she recently published a book on rational intuition. You can just look it up. So she looked at intuition from the perspective of biomedical engineering labs and how intuition develops with scientists there. So I naturally developed the instinct to look at cognition, and I really got interested in the field of imagination. So I wanted to study imagination in scientific thought experiments. But then I moved on into looking at imagination in mathematical problem solving by observing. So we gave certain structured and unstructured mathematical problems to professors and students of undergraduate students. And I looked at how problem solving is done in a group environment as well as in individual problem solving, mathematical problem solving environment. So yeah, that was my work during the PhD. And I'm a mixed methods researcher, and I work with the Google Cloud Business Platform as a UX researcher. So I've had a mixed career as well. I initially started off my career as a market researcher. So we did a lot of modeling of consumer behavior for purchase and usage of products. That's how I started off my career, had a well flourishing career, but then my interest was leaning towards psychology, and then that's when I made a shift to psychology, and I was supposed to get back to industry, but I was encouraged to apply for a position, and I applied for a position at Christ University for an assistant professor. I developed deeper understanding and deeper love for psychology and research.
Not that intuitive there.
Yeah, digital products. Yeah. So when I started teaching is when I actually developed more interest in psychology and research, especially qualitative research. So most of my quant experience was in industry, but qual experience developed in academics, and I worked as an intern at a couple of hospitals, and that's when I developed a deeper interest in case history taking and the closer link of the work that we were doing. Sorry about that. Yeah.
Not your fault,
sir. Right. So that's where a closed link between various qualitative research methods and practically what we were getting in the field. Okay, audible now? All right, great. So that's when I developed a deeper understanding of qualitative research and what it means to be a qualitative researcher. And that's when I realized that that users are or people have to come at the center of what we are doing and developing for them, right? Rather than develop products and then look at how people use it. So these were some of the thoughts that was influencing me deeper. And to look at and put the user or the person at the center of what we are doing, and then look at how their life is transforming, right? Suppose that I've been working in a couple of, I worked across industry on a couple of interesting projects, which I would like to share. So this is my pre-Google research. I had the pleasure of working with people with Down syndrome. I remember I had a lot of psychology background in terms of master's and PhD, but when this project came up, I was quite confident that this would be managed. People with Down syndrome, to just give you a brief background, these are people with impaired cognitive abilities, which means that simple decision making for everyday life and language, and they struggle with various cognitive abilities for a daily survival, right? And so I worked with a hospital called KIMS, and there were some of children who were undergoing psychoeducation and a lot of other behavioral training program at KIMS. And one of the major factors was that we wanted to develop something to help them to make healthy food choices. If you observe people with Down syndrome, they're usually obese. And there is no motivation for them to adopt healthy food choice. So how can we build something or how can we enable technology to help them to make this healthy food choice was the primary challenge. And so I went in with a lot of confidence, but that grounded me to the reality that I know nothing about people in Down syndrome. And all the theoretical knowledge that I gathered was not serving me or helping me, right? And so that's when I met with psychoeducators of these people with Down syndrome. I met with nurses, I met with doctors, I met with caregivers, patients, right? To understand these people's lives. First, in any product development, there is usually some technical know-how with how we proceed, and there is decision taken by the various teams to look at, to draw the roadmap for the product and take it forward. But here in this case, I had to, so the ideal method was an ethnography that we call in qualitative research. So immerse yourself in the environment of the users to understand who they are. So that was my primary task. So it took a lot of while for me to immerse in their environment, to understand their lifestyle from a 360 degree perspective, right? And then it involved me to translate that information that I'd got into product and design development, which happened over a period of time. So one of the projects that's close to my heart, and we developed this between different technologies that we could adopt. We felt that we could build an app for them through which they could then interact with the app to make this healthy food choice. And we achieved that at the end of the day with a very low fidelity prototype that was developed and then tested with children with Down syndrome. Also worked on, so education is close to my heart because when I started teaching is when I realized that there was greater learning for me as a psychologist. That's when I learned real thinking in psychology, right? And as well as my love for teaching and being with students. So I worked in a company in US, and they were primarily into teaching people in the military, and they were teaching open science, open source intelligence courses. And so I proposed that we could create massive open online courses, and so went through the end-to-end process of development of these courses. So I had to work with curriculum experts, content designers, interaction designers, product teams, and also had to work with faculties to look at how content can be created to create an engaging content, and also gamification of the content to ensure that students would love the course and look at the practical applicability of the course in their their workforce, right? So I drove the entire development end to end, and at the end of the day, we had about 3,000 students who took this course. I just wanted to showcase some of the courses. This is still offered in US across multiple regions in US where students are taking this course online. The other significant project is there was an app that was developed by a company called Derma Life Sciences. Now we have various evidence-based practice of some activities that can actually help people that can help people in various conditions, right? So based on neuroscience learning, they had developed various activities or games that could help people in various conditions. So one of the conditions was that anxiety, generalized anxiety, which when I said there is clinical anxiety and generalized anxiety is workplace stress or any anxiety that a common man experiences, right? It's a spectrum. Whenever these conditions are present, it's really based on the spectrum. So we're looking at normal population who's experiencing anxiety, right? So how can we enable these people who are experiencing anxiety through continued actions or games that they can play? We can help build better neural plasticity so that they can, the conditions can be improved. Is what we were looking at. So I was a principal researcher there. So we went through evaluating people with this generalized anxiety and did a within group experimental design to see the efficacy of these games that were built into the app. So they already had this program running for quite some time. And the major task was for me to look at the efficacy of this and actually look at what is the impact it had for people with generalized anxiety. Although it's built for many other experiences like peak performance and other experiences that I need. Right, so I just wanted to showcase what are some of these activities that was built in the app. So on the left side, you can look at some puzzles and there are some activities that were performed. So the idea is to iterate. The program was designed for a few months, and every user who qualified had to be engaged on this brain level, mind level, and real life actions over a period of time. And we also had counselors who were there to enable these participants to play these games over a repeated period of time. And the understanding, and these games were backed by evidence-based research. That was published about the efficacy, how effective these games were in building neural plasticity. Right? So this was a digital experience that we had created. And from research, we found that playing these games over a period of time definitely improved people's mental health. Yeah, with that, I joined Google in December of 2021, so I completed about 1.8 years now, worked across three teams. I'm a certified design sprint leader as well. These are some things that I wanted to highlight. As a mixed method researcher, we look at quant, qual, and other studies that we continuously work with the product engineering and design teams, right? With this, I would like to end my conversation. I had hidden these slides, so because I had to email this, I cannot present some confidential information. So with this, I would like to end here.
Thank you. Thanks, Rob. So, as again, I will sort of park the questions for the time being. So I'll invite our next speaker, Kane, one of our alumni. Again, switch. All right, our next speaker is Shantanu Kulkarni, my batchmate from CPDM. So we have fought enough when we were at CPDM. We still fight on what is design, and we continue to do that. So Shantanu is a UX designer, a design professional with 18 years of experience, over 18 years of experience, extensive experience in designing and leading design teams for enterprise products and cloud infrastructure software, including telecom, finance, and physical product systems, like vehicle dash panels, steering systems, and so on. He's been instrumental in setting up the UX design teams at various places like Veritas and VMware. With a focus on design thinking, Shantanu has done extensive work in incubating design practice in product teams with the focus of design thinking. He's also been an advocate of service design thinking and has been incorporating these practices into his work. He currently works for Google and leads an UX team for Google Cloud in Bangalore. So as I said, he's a graduate of the CPDM M.Des Programme. Before that, he's done engineering from University of Pune. Yours?
No, sir, thanks.
Okay, so yes. So what a wonderful evening. I mean, a couple of academicians and a practitioner, passionate practitioner, who's actually, by the way, my senior, Rajesh. And I still call Ram as an academician because he has that attitude, and his work is actually a reflection of that. So I'll quickly go through. Audible? Okay. So I'll go through my journey. Vishal just talked about it briefly. I worked at various places, started as a, I would say, ergonomist, because I was dealing with human factors in the vehicle systems, not an industrial designer, but more oriented towards engineering. And then I shifted my focus to digital products and, you know, worked at various places. So, and what has been the journey? Like, you know, I just want to point out at a very abstract level, like, you know, how I was, and I mean, people like me at my age and, you know, my generation, when we started practicing design in the industry, it was a different era altogether. I call myself a pre-iPhone era designer, because 2008, probably not everything changed, everything remained the same, but the perception of everything changed, sort of, right? Because of the smartphones and the, you know, the introduction of iPhones. So, of course, from following the process to questioning and reinventing the process is something that that I have seen over the period of time. Developing frameworks for collecting data, code-related information, and derived insights. Professor Seema actually talked about data visualization, right? Information visualization and things like that. So I've seen this journey where we were essentially talking about data, then we talked about information, now we are talking about insights, right? So, you know, that's the transformation that we have seen in the technologies as well as in the people. So reflective, this is more important in my opinion, because we have to, as designers, we have to get into the problem to understand the problem and get out of the problem to solve it, right? So this back and forth is extremely important, and it's something that we, it's not easy to do, right? We have to learn over the period of time, art of doing this, that, you know, be with the user, be in the context to understand, but come out of it to solve it. We cannot, it's very difficult. I cannot say it is impossible, but it is difficult to solve the problem being inside the problem, right? I cannot solve my own marriage problem. Vishal can probably advise me to solve that, right? And so is the case with Vishal. Okay, and I also did one thing that, you know, that actually helped me a lot. I actually wrote designer's diary. Okay, so every week, Friday, I used to write, sit for like half an hour and write a diary of my experiences, my journey throughout the week. And that I used to reflect back after some time. So that actually helped me. And this is my belief, right? Myths are largely made up of truth, right? And as researchers, we assume, we hypothesize, and we test, validate hypothesis. And I'm not a researcher, I'm not a methodical researcher, but I believe in some of these quotes which actually drive me. Also, Orwell said this, that, you know, myths which are believed in tend to become truth, right? And that's so true. And we have to dream first. We have to create that myth and think about it again and again to become this as a truth. Why am I telling this to you now? Because when I started, it was a long time back, and we have come a long way as designers, and especially UX designers, because industrial design practice was, I will not say it was fully matured, but it was getting matured, right? It was accepted in the industry, but the UX design is, I would say, it is in the teens now. It is not nascent, but it is getting mature over the period of time. But when we started, it was very difficult. Okay, so we were, I mean, if you know the story, the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, right? It is the poor Charlie who did not even know that he is actually going to be the owner of this chocolate factory. Okay, so we were the poor Charlies, where we didn't know that we are going to own this entire product thinking, product design, right? And we are the epicenter of everything that is happening in, at least in the UX industry. And when I say UX, it is basically design or experience design applied to digital products. So I'm representing that industry today.
And I equate this is to yak sharing. Look up for this term. Actually, this is very important. Sometimes it is taken in a very negative sense because we are doing unnecessary work for a long time, which is not letting us focus on the right thing to do. But we did yak sharing for a long time. Okay, we did quant research, we did call research, and you know, people did not realize that why it is important. And suddenly, we think that, hey, this is the thing that we have to do. This is the thing that we have to start with. Right. Okay, so I will divide my journey in like four parts, or the kind of work that I did was design for users, design for journeys, design for systems or design with systems, and design for society or so with society. Okay, so these are probably the four parts that I will try to cover. And then we always look for simplicity, right? I conducted this workshop a week back with the students here, and we talked about simplicity, right? And tried to define what is simplicity, right? So I have been working with enterprise products all throughout, and especially in the cloud domain, cloud tech enterprise. A very difficult domain because it is non-relatable to some extent, because we cannot, if you are actually designing a travel app, it is easy for us to relate to, or even say, for example, banking experiences or banking app, right? But this type of applications are difficult to relate to, right? So what I started with was this type of work, okay? And I was always behind the simplicity. And then I later realized simplicity in the enterprise digital experience is a little different, right? I experimented a lot with data visualization, okay, and a combination of data and information visualization in tandem. Like, how can we show textual data and a graphical interface in tandem, and how can they actually work together to give what users wants? We also, like, you know, this is an example of a network inside product where we developed this domain specific language, which is called ESL, right? And that time, NLP and all these algorithms were not very strong, but still we were able to do this, very efficiently. So I was talking about complexity and simplicity, right? So apparent complexity versus operational simplicity, right? So the products were and are apparently very complex, but they are operationally very simple. Okay, so we the key takeaway here is that, you know, we cannot think simplicity as a thing that we have to do always, right? Our lives are complex. Our ecosystems are complex, right? So we should find a way to live with it, right? And find a way to operationally make things simple. Okay, so what we essentially did was we actually transformed data to information to insights, okay? And we tried to reduce the data density and balancing it with actionability. Okay, so what is insight? If you look at the anatomy of the insight, right, it is an actionable form of data and information. So if you take data from the source, make it more usable. So usable form of data is information, and actionable form of information is insight. That is exactly what we did. So very simple visualization in the beginning, maybe important for CTOs to look at how their network is doing in their IT infrastructure. But if you drill down, you can actually look at the details for all those actionable insights. Again, one more example, like, you know, what is relevant is more important irrespective of like busy screens. So if you look at this screen, you will say that, hey, there is a lot of content there, but all of it is more relevant, extremely relevant for the users. So what we have to do is we should not just minimize, we should optimize, right? Optimize the information, right? Make it more actionable. Whatever is required for users is what you have to actually give them, right? Don't try to minimize overly. Thoughtfully productive versus unintentionally reductive. Okay, we are always told to reduce information. Okay, even if we have to have empty spaces, we have to reduce information and controls. That is something that we should thoughtfully do. We have to be thoughtfully productive. So all this approach that we had initially, right? I had initially, I translated that into a patent that I filed, and it was granted, and I actually applied that patent into these sort of visualizations of, you know, looking at a very complex IT ecosystems and how can we group them, how can we make them actionable, etc. Right? So this patent was mainly on the data visualization part, and it was a utility sort of a patent. Then came to a point where I started thinking about, of course I was thinking about journeys even earlier, but I tried to apply all those learnings into, you know, what I say design for journeys, right? So we thought about journey maps last week, right? You know, we did extensively, like, you know, the journey maps to understand the context, right? Context and the journeys. We were the probably my team. I tried to actually adopt this JTBD framework, like jobs to be done framework, very early when it was introduced. Okay, so I'll not get into the details of that, but what is more important here is that we have to think of jobs rather than use cases. So we should not think about what we have to do, like user has to do in that moment, but also think about what is their journey and, you know, what is the goal that they want to achieve. Then came to a point when I thought that, okay, I mean, products are important, but systems are actually more important. So some of these, the trend that we have seen in the industry is that, you know, maybe around 15 years back or 10, even 10 years back, many companies were actually designing products. They're still designing products, but they are also thinking about solutions, right? Industry-specific solutions, and, you know, they are also thinking about ecosystems, right? Apple is one such ecosystem. Like, you know, it started, you know, that ecosystem thing, right? And every company is now actually looking at ecosystems. So I pivoted my thinking from design thinking to product thinking, right? So try to understand the business aspects, try to understand the product lifecycle aspect of things rather than just the users aspect, right? So systemic thinking versus only user-centric thinking is something that we have to think. And this is exactly what I like about CPDM. I think right from the word go, CPDM is actually instructed. The students are instructed to think about systems rather than just users. That led me, with my engineering colleagues, we filed another patent for designing a system, designing a product. It was nothing but it was not a product. It was actually a platform of sorts for managing the network of the IT infrastructure. So this was a very complex one. If I start talking about it in detail, probably take a couple of hours, but this is basically an idea of a new product and offering to our customers. So finally, it came to society, right? Again, I mean, all this work that I did was with the corporates, and in 2008, I started working with an NGO called Akshar Bharati, and we and few friends thought that we actually have done a good work in donating books to the schools in the remote area of Maharashtra. At that time, we were extensively working on that project, and we actually donated around 400 libraries. I mean, one library could contain around 800 to 1,000 books. Traveled all across Maharashtra, stayed in the villages with the local people, and we did that. And we realized that we are actually donating, we are not enabling. Okay, so we are not getting feedback from them or empowering them, rather. So really, I found this organization called Being Volunteer with some of my friends. I strongly believe that if we have to work in these areas, right, we have to do something which we can do the best. So what we realize, there are many NGOs which are working on the ground, but there is nobody who is connecting them to the volunteers and the CSR. Okay, got it. So I will skim through it very fast. So we directly work on the ground with a lot of tree plantation in the environment. We enable people with a lot of livelihood development also. Like, you know, it was not just that, you know, one-time tree. Again, I mean, here, if you look at, you know, we just not just focus on the tree plantation, we actually focused on tree nurturing. If you look at the number of trees nurtured are actually more than we planted. So that is the, I mean, we also focus on the ecosystem there because we planted the native trees. These products were designed and developed by, not by us, but, you know, we actually tied up with a lot of innovators to come up with these products. Okay, so some of these rice mills and, you know, these food processing units are actually designed and developed, and we also patented these products. And we use these products to deploy this product in certain areas, and, you know, increase the livelihood. CCAF, of course, I mean, these are COVID affected families. We help them directly. Of course, these are direct help that we did. Flood relief we did, like, you know, I myself went through a lot because we went to a lot of villages. It was flood, I mean, especially the South Maharashtra at that time was badly affected. So I went to many places and actually helped on the ground. So we did a groundwork, balance of groundwork, as well as a lot of empowerment. This is another project, which is clean water through clean energy. So we had, of course, had solar panels to run the purifier for a lot of schools in Maharashtra. Another interesting project that we took up, I mean, this is my friend, architect friend. So this was an eco-housing. So what we did was we the architect friend of mine actually developed a concept of how to build a house with a single bag of cement. And it's not the actual cement, but it's the equivalent of a single bag of cement energy that is required to create that cement, basically. Right? So this is the whole process of creating that mud house with the local material. And we actually created this. So we used to call it as mud workshops. We actually created those houses with our own hands, rammed the bricks with the local soil. And this is actually the right-hand side images that you see is my native, one of my native places. And, you know, there we actually constructed these houses. All right, thank you. So I just wanted to end my journey. So I hope I was able to give a lot of information.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah, Ram, if you could join. Yeah. So what I'll do is I'll ask the questions to be asked now before we go into my part of the panel discussion.
Okay, I think I'll persist with the microphone for a while just to see whether I can. All right, if I may ask, request the other panelists to also come on the camera. So we'll have all the four of you on the camera. So Seema and Rajesh, if you could also please.
Yeah, I'm sorry, okay. My electricity is gone.
Oh, aww. No problem. Systems problem, right? Yeah, no issues. So, questions, please. So, if somebody can take the mic around, and even our alumni online can also ask questions. So, anyone, please raise your arms, and we'll come to you for the questions. Okay, anyone here? And please direct if it's to an individual or it's open to the panel.
My question is for Ram, sir. Sir, you mentioned in one of your projects, like there are two actions, brain actions and mind actions. Can you elaborate the difference? Like, I didn't get it.
Mind level actions are more of cognitive tasks. Like if I give you a puzzle, it's a more of a thought process that goes into it, and you have to think through how the puzzle has to be solved. Brain actions are some actions that you can do unconsciously. I'm trying to think of the actions that we had developed. Brain actions were built in the form of some activities on the app where they had to some of the tasks were timed, and so we saw a rapid, I'm not able to recollect the exact games. There were 4 or 5 games that had to be played. And one of the metrics was that we had to measure them on time, and we had to track the time of action they would perform on the games for the period of time. And for every week, if there was a reduction in time of them completing those actions on the app, then we determined that there was some improvement on the brain level neural plasticity. my interactions was more about journaling. My interactions were more about solving puzzles where cognitive activity was involved on a perceptual basis.
Sir, my next question is for Rajesh, sir. You told about the last SUV design, it was more sensors kind of thing. The one thing you focused, like the lights were of the concepts of ice cubes. So can you tell what are the thought behind that thinking of the lights on the basis of ice cubes?
Yeah, first of all, if you have seen new Nexa products, in all our Nexa products being it Berlino, Grand Vitara, or France, you can see in the headlamps as well as in RCL, we are using three dot lamp signature. As soon as you see those three dots, you would be able to identify that it's a Nexa product and it's a Maruti product. That's the first thing. That's the reason why we have three dots in the headlamp and RCL. Secondly, there's lots of design work that has been gone into headlamps and RCLs. Currently, the car design is all about headlamps and RCLs. So when we thought, what can the new thing we can do in our headlamp? So the inspiration came for us, like we want to be a crystal, like an ice crystal. And that's how we try to design our headlamps around it. So it's more to do with we need to honor the technical requirements, but also to create a new image, a new interesting detail. So the inspiration for the designer came from the ice crystals. Yeah.
Thanks, Rajesh. This question back to Ram. So quite intrigued with the kind of work you're doing. And actually I have questions to guide myself on the research we're doing in this area. So when you talked about some of the methods which you developed into app, which were research-backed. There was already evidence for them that it is useful and therefore it is. I presume that's the case for these apps, and that's why you could probably take them to the clinical side. Were these also done on the ethics approval process to try out something new, or did you have to, you could take them straight away?
Absolutely. It went through a review board.
Okay.
So it went through independent review board of two universities. One, because I was associated with Christ University at that time,
right.
We went through an internal review board where, in fact, all the papers that were taken into consideration for development of the games were sent to the review board. And because of my association, we needed an independent review board. So we went to someone in Nimhans,
okay,
and got that review. And only then it was
right. Even though there was evidence before, still to make it into an app that was required, right?
Yes. So this app was quite successful. They had built it in United States with an association with a university. And we wanted to replicate some of those games in India and check the efficacy of those games with the Indian population.
Okay.
But we could not go with what with the ethical review board of the United States. So we went through ethical review board here, and two universities have to approve it. So go ahead with it.
The point I wanted to bring this in was
So you're trying to build a product and translate some of the actual real life. Correct. Right. So the question is, There are real life actions that has to be translated into digital technology platforms. Because the intervention is different between the real life and the digital life, although it's the same actions, do we need ethical considerations? Absolutely. When we talk about digital products, we talk about a lot of different things. We talk about how digital products can become addictive, how digital products can be engaging, right? So not only in terms of the product performance, but in terms of how the users are adopting it and integrating into their lifestyle, right? So even though you're replicating an action ground up from a real life scenario into an app, it definitely has to go through different cycles and different people composition in the ethical review board to review and give a confirmation about the impact the user would have. So my recommendation is to have a review board that has a composite of people who are looking at impact of digital technologies. And in my case, we had a neuroscientist because of the brain level neuroplasticity. We had a general counselor who looked at mental health problems. And also we had a digital technology expert as a review board. So that's my recommendation.
My question is to Mr. Rajesh Maruti. This is regarding the DFMA. So I assume that this design, you are into moving to styling, and this always goes in concurrently with the product development. So have you faced, have any manufacturing engineers told you that, sorry, we cannot make this shape? So have you faced such constraints? And over the course of your career, has the manufacturing technology evolves such that now you get more freedom to realize your ideas in the shape?
Of the time, people, engineers come and tell us we cannot make this. For last 20 years, the technology has evolved and the processes have evolved, but people thinking is not. So anything new you propose, anything new you want them to try, they do not, because they want to play it safe for various reasons. I do not blame them, because tested sections or the gap and LD, whatever you call them. So they want to stick to those. Okay, so and so manufacturer is doing exactly the same section. Suzuki, our parent company, is doing exactly the same thing. You follow the same section or detail or whatever. So at times we have to fight with them, and we do extensive benchmarking, and we propose, and in fact we show them how it can be made. So oftentimes the responsibility lies on the designer's shoulder, how much he wants to protect his design and how much he wants to fight with engineers. So I think the friction between engineers and the designers would continue, but over the time you learn how to deal with them, and also how to take them on your side in order to get things done. It's a challenging thing to work with them. For example, again, if I come towards Franks, I said in the aerodynamics perspective also, they asked us to remove the negative surface that was there in the end of the hood. So that cannot be made in a sheet metal. So the engineering team came along and they supported us. Okay, if you want that, we would split the hood and make it in plastic. So even though that was expensive, they end up splitting the sheet metal, and part of it they made in the plastic, and rest of the hood was made in sheet metal. So there are some engineers, passionate engineers, they come along and also they support you. But at the same time, most of the time we face resistance for new things.
My question is to Shantanu. So you had actually our experience of going through a patent process successfully. Many of the work that is done in CPDM, especially at PhD level, they develop interfaces, visualizations. So do you recommend them to going through this process if they see as a novelty? Because this is quite tricky to define. One is a novelty. Second is what is the learning that happens in the process of making the board, and third is a ROI maybe potential.
Okay, so yeah, difficult question, but of course everybody who is trying to do something new has to have it. It is imperative that, you know, we should file the rights in whatever way, whether it is copyright or whatever, right? So the only thing that, you know, in case of interaction design or, you know, digital design patents, and maybe Seema can talk more about it, is that, you know, it's not the actual visual which is patented. It's the utility of the visual which is patented. Right, and the utility, we have to understand, utility is the use in context, okay, to solve a specific problem. Okay, so if you look at the visuals that are patented, it is not the visual, it is not those data visualizations, and I cannot claim that, you know, they have reused my data visualization, but if I can claim if they have reused my data visualization for a specific purpose. Okay, so everything, anything new has to be patented, but there has to be some utilitarian perspective to it. That is important. And in case of interaction design patents, that is also what is measured. I don't know if I've answered, but I can get back to you if we take it.
Yeah, just a quick comment. If you notice, both of his patents were US PTOs. In India, some of these are difficult process patents, and some of these patents are a little tricky in India compared to US. We'll take one more question there. Okay, while the mic is going there, I'll put one question. This is to Seema. So the first part where you had those stories, especially the Kerala backwaters, those, I forgot the name that you had for these private cleaning spaces or utility areas. I think, as you said, in terms of data collection and sharing of data, that was very powerful compared to just having the data in there. But when you have photographs in there, a lot of people fail to read photographs adequately, even though there's a lot of information there in terms of the end users of, let's say, the data. When you write it down explicitly, they know that this is what data is. When you just give them a set of pictures, people might fail to see what you want them to see. So have you sort of come across this, and how do you sort of tackle the problems around those?
Yeah, so normally in documentary photography, we support it with text. It's not just visuals. So exhibitions or publications, what is not there in the picture is what we write in the text. So this is a practice there, but the photo viz is something different. Photo viz is normally not without text, so it is. The idea is to kind of find the pattern. You will have the same thing repeating, very similar to the numbers, but then so the idea is to kind of look at large number of such pictures and then come to some sort of a conclusion. I think it also depends on the beholder, right? I mean, who some people wants to look at things in detail. Some of them just, skim through it. Yeah, so I think two ways to look at.
I think, as you said, probably it's a lot to do with the experience of the person seeing the data as well, right?
Yeah. Right, yeah, yes.
Yeah, thank you. We'll take the last question.
So my question is to any of the practitioners from the industry. So usually as a part of the design course here, we tend to make prototypes and proof of concepts for our ideas and designs. So how is the design for manufacturing a shift in the process, and how does the industry or practitioners approach design for manufacturing? Like, how is it different from making a prototype or a proof of concept? So, could you, to any of the practitioners?
Paid person to respond to this question. So the question is, when you are doing the initial proof of concepts and so on, how do you account for DFMA? The early prototypes and so on. Oh, Rajesh, was I audible?
Vishal, could you please repeat it? There's something wrong with the sound. I'm unable to hear properly.
Is this better now?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so the question is that when you do the early proof of concepts, your early prototypes, how do you account for DFMA at that stage?
So, yeah, I mean, unless until absolutely needed, we do not go for proto making. Because our industry is different. Here the stakes are quite high, even the investments are quite high. So the most of the simulation happens in you have computer aided simulation, and we do rely on them majorly for any kind of testing before we go on to actual production. But currently UI UX, there is a team that is formed in Maruti, and they are working. So when they are testing, for example, they are developing a new interface. For them, the stakes are not so high. In fact, that's something they need to test before we actually put in the car. So on a component basis, they do go ahead and make prototypes. Having said that, before we go for final production, in car industry, we make design protos. So say 20, 30 cars we make, all of them are proto. We call them design protos. They, in order to do extensive testing on them and also to validate whether everything is working when all the components together in reality. So we do check them. And these cars are expensive. They almost like each one would cost 100 to 150 crores. So altogether 20, 30 cars would cost that much for us. But we do make protos. The industry heavily relies on technology that is available so that we don't have to spend money in making protos unless until it is absolutely needed. Even the management would not give us approval to make prototypes.
Yeah. I think with that, we'll move on to the next part of the panel discussion. All of you, in some sense, have covered a bit of this, but I'll still, as a good student, go through all of these questions so that, at the end of it, I'm looking at that book which comes out eventually, where I can specifically point out your specific answers to those questions. So I'll start with the people online and then go in the same round. So Rajesh, what does design or designing mean to you? I mean, given all this experience, what are the standout features? Again, very broad questions, but specific answers, so making it challenging.
Yeah, Vishal, I think when you come out of the college, design is all about making a fancy sketch. And it's all about sketch. It's all about what you draw on paper and holding on to the creation you created and admiring that creation. But over the years, I realized it's not just making a fancy sketch, but making that into a reality. That's where the actual design process starts. So there is lots of learning you go through because you need to respect engineers, you need to respect the laws, you need to respect the customer, you need to respect the internal customer like marketing. So there are lots of things. Everybody has an opinion when it comes to design. So navigating through all those and still making your sketch into a reality, that is a whole design process. So in colleges, people think, okay, I can make a sketch and that's it. I am the designer the world has been waiting for. So that's not the case at all. So you need an army, at least in the car industry, you need army of people who can make that sketch into a reality. So you need to respect and you need to work, learn to work and along with them. So for me, design is more like a problem solving. As I said, I showed Baleno, I showed Franz. So you are given very strong constraints in terms of engineering, in terms of feasibility, And in terms of investment from management side, within those boundaries, we want something radically different. If both cars are sitting next to each other, people cannot make a difference. They cannot make out that both are made on the same thing. So that is for me a problem solving. It's a visual problem solving. That is what a car design is all about nowadays. Yeah.
You, Seema, the same question.
Okay. I am going a little philosophical. See, I think, you know, yes, what Rajesh said is also from one particular industry, but I would suggest, people should start looking, connecting the dots actually, because even if it is a car industry, there are larger implications of climate and resources and all of these things. But I think one of the problems that our students generally feel, generally saying, everybody has to start doing this connection of dots. Otherwise, it's going to be very difficult. That's what I think, has to happen. Yeah. I don't know.
Definitely, Seema. And I think connecting the dots, and I was getting to this point, of course, it is problem solving, but I think it is more about letting the users or whoever is the audience, right, make sense of what is happening around them, right? So giving them some sense through whatever artifacts or, whatever we create or whatever we do not create. Sometimes we say that, no design is the best design. We don't have to implement, right? So that is probably what design is. And also, in my opinion, strongly, I believe that, again, I talked about simplicity, right? Is about removing barriers between what they want to do and what their interface is, basically, right? So removing the interface itself, making it more and more transparent, is what is design is, okay? So if I'm living in a house, I'm living in a house with my family, right? That is what I'm doing. Okay. I'm not living in the house. I'm living with my family. Okay. So we have to understand the subtle differences here and think about design in that way. Okay. So we are not designing artifacts. We are actually creating those experiences and being more and more transparent. That is what design is to me. And I'm still figuring it out. Yeah.
I think we are all figuring it out. For me, design is a mindset. And what do we mean by a mindset, right? We don't start with the product. We always start with the challenge. And what is the challenge somebody is facing, right? And it's users or people who are facing these challenges. And so where does the problem statement occur? Right? Problem statements occur usually from your own experience in your life, right? And you observe the problem, and the problem deeply impacts you. And based on the problem, because it is impacting you, you think of a solution to it. And what is the solution? And how do you take the solution forward, right? So the translating the problem into a solution is where you're changing somebody's life or changing the user's life to the better. And by adopting a product or a design or a technology or anything that relates to design, you're putting the person from one state A to state B, right? And what is the transition that person is having? And how do you design for that transition to enhance the person's life is what I think is design. And design is not new. It started off as a very early concept. Don Norman talks about products and their interaction with people. And if you see a person struggling with something, it's not that the person is not able to think through, but it's the problem of the design, right? It's a problem of the product. So mindset is what is design is my take on it.
All right, I've just realized that I'm really sort of not a good anchor, so we have been sort of absolutely out of schedule, but I hope we can still continue for another half an hour. We still have to listen to our alumni.
Yeah, if you can just bear with us for sort of another half an hour. So just give me a thumbs up to all the alumni there, because you would want to hear you as well. I'll quickly try to get all the questions through so that we don't get delayed. So just please at least leave a hint that you can stay back. What I'll do is I'll quickly run through for short answers at least. So the next question, which is back to mindset, is that the society looks at designers as designers. That's the society's way of looking at designers. And then you are studying, then you also, as you some of you said, Rajesh said as well, right, that when you are studying, you think that you want to be that designer who has the influence in the society as well, right? And there's a reality out there. So how do you navigate this transition between how society sees you as a designer, how you see yourself as a designer, and how you realize what it is to design over a period of time? So again, we'll start maybe Ram with you, and please keep it short.
I'm a UX researcher, but I'll speak from the perspective of the experience that I've had with designers. The fundamental problem that the challenge that we have is a designer doesn't work as an independent individual, right? They are in the mix of people who are thinking about product, people who are thinking about engineering the product. They're working with researchers, they are working with users, right? And usually not everything that the designer creates is translated into a product. And there is a constant tension of what needs to be translated, what the designer thinks and what aspects of what the designers thought could be translated into product and engineering. So there's a constant tension between there. That's one. Second, between research and design. So how do you know what has to be designed? So there are design principles, there are design standards that are existing there. But given the user challenges that designers have to address, are they effectively be able to capture all the pain points that the users face into what aspect of those can be translated into a design is another challenge that they face.
So what is probably a society's perspective, right, for a designer? I think, in my opinion, in this era, of course, we had industrial revolution, and we have Silicon Revolution, and now it's time for us to think about humans in the loop, right? So we are responsible for keeping humans in the loop for anything and everything that is happening, right? So many religions, or rather all the religions, had rituals or have rituals which were designed for human beings to behave in a society with some protocol, right? We are now responsible for the same society to behave with the interfaces with certain protocol, right? So we are here not just to solve their problems or, you know, cater to their needs, but also influence them, influence the society to behave in a certain way, in the right way. So we have a larger responsibility.
Right, Seema, same question.
Yeah, my situation is bad. You know, the moment I step out, people ask, are you a fashion designer? So I don't think things have changed much for me. But I think, you know, I think designers are capable of doing more. I resonate with what Ram was, I forgot. Shantanu was saying. The thing is, you know, there is also some fear I generally see with the designers talking a bit political and, you know, all of that. Why everybody refrains from that, I'm not sure. But I think, you know, there are larger systemic changes that can be made, larger policy changes that designers can actually take up. So some of these things are slightly politically connected. I think we should start talking in slightly more larger terms and not getting scared of, you know, really, yeah, connecting it.
Sure. Yeah, thanks, Rajesh.
I think the way society views, of course, when you come to car design, they see us completely different as like as a fancy job we are having. But from the user perspective, we are in a way empathize with the user, and we try to give a solution that is attractive and which makes their life much more comfortable and easier. So I think from society perspective, there is an expectation from them on designers that we really understand their needs, whatever, including aspirational needs, and translate them into a tangible, attractive product. I think that's what is expected. If we disconnect from that reality, again, we would be creating some beautiful objects, but that mean nothing for a customer. They would not like to own or drive or go and invest their hard-earned money. So for us, in understanding the user, and I said, Ram used pain points, addressing the pain points. We also address not only the pain points, but aspirational desires. I purely talk from car industry. So that's the society's expectation from us. Yeah.
Right. So my last question to the panel, and we'll start with you, Rajesh, given that you are already with the open mic. So you have now about 18, 20 years of experience in the industry. And as you said, when you graduate, you have a certain idea of design. And as you evolve, you have certain other ideas of design. So how has your sort of understanding of design evolved? There's some hint to that. But what are the specific instances or events that have shaped it? So if you could point to very specific things and in what way it has shaped your understanding of design.
So I think Vishal, last month I finished 20 years. So one of the cars for one of the projects, I went to Japan. I keep it very brief. So we were working on a scale model, and my senior, a sensei, we call teacher. So he was a senior designer, and he asked me to put a tape on a scale model. Scale model is like 1.3 meter long. So I put a tape, and I put it in 2 minutes, and it is done. I called him, okay, I have done it. And then the process of refinement started. He said, okay, front raise the tape by 1 mm and rear of the tape. Basically, I'm defining the shoulder of a car. So he said, rear bring it down by few millimeters. And I would put it. And again, he come. Okay, well, rear raise it by 0.5 mm and front bring it down by 2 mm. So that whole process went on for whole afternoon. So that taught me something very important. In a sense, design is not just making something. But without getting tired, you keep on refining it till that line is absolutely beautiful in all views. So that's the biggest learning for me, because iPhone does not just, the designer did not create iPhone just like that. It is so simple because somebody made it that simple, like the Shantanu was talking. I would imagine the amount of man hours that would have gone into refining each and every edge of that iPhone, finding the right radius, finding the right proportion, finding the right thickness. So there is an incredible work that goes on to get good designs. So a designer is never happy with what he has created, but he constantly refines it until the deadline comes.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, Rajesh. Seema, same question.
Okay. So I'll take a little time on this. So I was just thinking about, some of my previous answers also comes from a certain level of experience in the past. So I'm from Kerala, and I have lived very close to some of the social movements that happened at a very interesting period of time, so some of them include, at that point I never thought there were it had anything to do with design. I thought it as more social experiments. So we had popular science movements, we had literacy movements that is happening, total literacy campaign, which sort of inspired later the nation. There were participatory democracy programs, some of these things which actually brought in a lot of larger systemic change, which because of that I have benefited. I think Kerala has benefited overall in the long term. So later when you start looking at, as things evolved, now when I look back, these are basically, in a sense, system design projects, social design projects of a very interesting nature. So I think my understanding of design is in that state right now. No, I don't see it as a small thing that is happening in one corner. I think there are larger things possible and larger changes are possible, and there is benefits to the society. So that is where one point of view. Now specifically, I'm looking at some person. If I have to say a couple of names. One is Laurie Baker, who is also was practicing as an architect in Kerala. And now, he was talking about all the things that we are talking now in terms of sustainable architecture in 1970s. And I've had this wonderful opportunity to see him very close working in the field. So that has influenced me a lot, that is as a person. Second person, probably also, I think the crowd also should know, he's Professor S. Balram. He was one of the first faculties of National Institute of Design, and I later had the opportunity to work with him for a very long time. And so the interesting thing which I would like to say is that he's also one of the first person who might have connected what Indian design is and, the general socio-cultural political aspects of India. So now, very interesting things he was talking about in his book, Thinking Design, which is about, how the national movement had a design element. So he was trying to connect Gandhi's way of representing him in the public and the semiotics of it. So this was one of the first instances I remember, somebody tried to connect the design, the contemporary design and the social reality of India. So in that way, these couple of people have influenced as specific people. Yes. Yeah.
So if I have to take one name, probably it is Edward Tufte for data visualization. But yes, I think it's not just like one process or a person, anything that influenced me, but it is basically the nature, right, that influences everybody. Okay, so the one thing that I realized, if you look at nature, it is all decentralized. All the resources in the nature, everything is naturally very decentralized. Okay, it is not centralized. And why are we creating systems and interfaces which are centralized? Okay, so why can't we democratize a lot of things, the information that we have, or the way we interact with information, the way we use it? So that is probably one of the inspirations I have. But yeah, so from the data visualization perspective, it is Edward Tufte, which I get inspired from time to time. And pass on to Ram.
For me, design has evolved. My take is a little bit more practical, and we've seen evolution of tools that has afforded us to create better designs. And with the evolution of tools, as a researcher, there are also metrics that we need to develop to test and validate and evaluate these designs. And the more sophisticated tools that we build to build these metrics and test these designs, I think it gives a better feedback both to the design product and even the users who are using it, right? So one example is called the HART model that we follow. And HART is happiness, engagement, adoption, retention, and task success, right? So happiness could be tracked in terms of ease of use of the product. And ease of use comes from design, right? Design is essentially to ensure that people intuitively use the product. So there are attitudinal measures, there are behavioral measures, there are experiential measures, which can be quantified or sort of build qualitative measures through which we can get responsive feedback on design and build. And based on the feedback that you get quantitatively and qualitatively, and the sort of metrics that you build to measure these are extremely important, which sort of feedbacks into how design will evolve in future. And that's my take on it.
All right, with that, we'll thank all the panelists for their lovely inputs. Now I'll ask the alumni who are online to please come on the camera. And we have Pushpendra here. Anyone else from your batch here? Yeah, so please come in the front, at least. Please come on the camera and introduce yourselves, what you have been doing since you graduated, your journey. I know I've lost a couple of people because of the extended timeline, but. Mukund, Nitin, Poshit, Shpendra, I'd seen Amy as well, but I don't see her anymore. All right, can you guys please come on the camera and talk about yourselves?
Me a minute, Vishal.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, so maybe we'll start with Pushit. So yeah, all yours, please tell us about your journey since graduating from CPDM.
Hey guys, yeah. So I graduated CPDM in 2013. And then I got placed in TVS Motors. So I was an industrial designer over there for a branch called IISc for advanced engineering system. And I worked on casings and different type of designing and shaping objects in TVS for a year. I somehow felt it was not my cup of tea. And then I gradually moved to UX design. I went to Samsung R&D from there on. And then I worked there for about 5 to 6 years. I worked on wearables, I worked on smartphones, I worked on AR, all sort of things that I could get my hands on, and the Samsung R&D India was working on. It was a really good place to kind of explore and start your journey as a UX designer. So from there on, I moved to SAP during COVID, and then I worked on indirect taxes, working on applications for. And then now I'm working with Honeywell from past 1.5 years, close to about 2 years now. And here I'm working as a lead for designing software for the whole of the US and Europe market in fire safety systems. And all in all, throughout my journey, starting from CPDM actually, I've gathered about 13 patents. Most of them published, and then some of them granted as well. So it's been a really good experience so far.
Nitin, I'll go last.
Yeah, sure. Only three of us are there. Okay, hi everyone. My name is Nitin. I graduated in 2013. Thank you, Professor Vishal, for inviting us, especially, you know, bringing all of us together again. It was a very interesting talk, and but somehow we keep, I mean, at least me, I keep skipping all your, all this amazing talks. And today I'm really feeling that regret that, you know, why I've been, missing all these wonderful talks. After graduating from IISc, I, along with my senior, Mr. Vinay Reddy, we started Sickle Innovations. So we are into horticulture mechanization. And ever since, we have been doing just the same work. And I think for the rest of the life, we'll be doing the same. We design equipment for the farming community to solve problems which are being faced by horticulturists in the domain of harvesting, crop protection, and post-harvest, like drying solutions and grading and sorting. So in the last 10 to 11 years, we have gathered so many problems from the farms that, you know, for the rest of the life, we can keep solving it sitting in our studio. So that has been our journey. And thank you so much again for, bringing us together.
Thank you. Mukund, now there's no escape.
Yeah. So hi, I am myself Mukund. I graduated, in 2013, and I worked around for 4 years in General Motors as a crash and safety engineer. I did not take the exact design route. And as my batchmates knows that I was not really good at it. So then I joined Samsung Research. After that, I worked on drop and bending simulations of phones. And also I got to work a bit with the foldable phone that you currently see in the market. So after that, recently, in just a year before, I joined SABIC, which is a Aramco subsidiary. It is a petrochemical company. I joined their global application team as a senior scientist. And now I am since I am in the application space, I get to work with all kind of products, not just specific to consumer electronics or automotive like before. And as of now, I am working largely on electric vehicles. And other than that, different automotive, solar, pipe, many things that eventually gets built using polymers. So yeah, so not as many as POSIT, but I also have 2-3 patents that got published, one granted with Nitin. So Nitin and me, we had a patent with from our IISc days. That's mostly it. I am mostly in the engineering side of things, not too much into design, but whatever I learned has tremendously helped whenever I am faced with some issue and then I am not able to solve it. So yeah, thank you.
Hi, hello everyone. Myself Pushpendra. I am a little fortunate. I get to attend this the Silver Jubilee episodes in person. About my journey in short, I started working with rotating electrical machines at Bosch. And then for a short duration, I experienced how the development and research is approached in automotive components and engineering in other countries, maybe in Europe. And I attempted to implement the similar pace here. Then I worked with electric two-wheelers from some Indian OEMs, which are launched. So my small part was attempting to make them a little more death-proof before being launched into the market. And last, I worked with automotive filtration. So there was a learning on very old automotive components and processes and how we can find the implementation of modern technology, which we, from our present day, to filtration to the extent when we were in CPDM, upon being influenced by the environment at CPDM, it starts appearing to us that everything is design. So had some opportunity to immerse in filtration where it appears or all natural phenomena are possible to be looked upon as filtration. So yeah, thanks to Professor Vishal Singh for bringing us all together, seeing our batchmates again. We recall all the projects and adventures we executed in the institute, and very fortunate to hear the things you bring from the influencers in the field of design.
Right, thank you. So that's good to see you all here. And as you saw, Professor Singh just came in. So I think with that, we'll sort of close the session here. But before we do that, we have to do our formal closure. So I'll invite Professor Sen to kindly give the mementos. And just as a reminder, so all our speakers and panelists are our design ambassadors, CPDM design ambassadors, who we hope to have a relationship in the longer run as well, you know, talk about design, you know, connect with our students and of course faculty and alumni and so on. And part of that recognition is that we give mementos and a certificate of CPDM ambassadors. Those who are in person here, they get it. Those who are not in person here have to come to get it. We can, of course, post it, but we'll rather prefer the first option, right? So they need to be here at some point, give us talks and working sessions. So I'd like Professor Sen to kindly at least hand it over to Shantanu and Dr. Ram. Certificates are not marked yet because Professor Chakravarti is traveling. So we'll give the certificates, but we'll give the certificates again. So without the names, we'll put the pictures. Oh, and right. So we're giving a blind check for now. Please, Shantanu.
But he's already an ambassador. Okay, now onwards, you want him to be dedicated.
Oh, wait, for that, you need to speak here.
Yes. So, memento has got some relationship with memory, right? It is a sort of a reminder that you have been here, and then you say, oh, I have to tell some good things about them. Okay, and ignore certain bad things means if you hear something bad, right, you are wrong. Okay, so I'm telling you what is going to happen now. Okay, you are all on our side and will be helping us to become better and more visible to the rest of the world. Okay, so thank you for coming here.
And Dr. Ram Vivekananda.
I'm very happy.
So we'll come here not only to make you better, but we become better ourselves too.
Oh, that will be great. Yeah, so I know that, but you know, we want you to come again and again and become, both of us become better and better.
Thank you. With that, we'll close it here. But as said, I will expect to see all of you here at some point, right? And on the 25th of this event, we'll make it up in person. So all the alumni of all batches are expected to be here. And of course, as many of the CPDM ambassadors. I will also be doing an event either mid-October or in the first week of November. So we'll keep you posted on that. So that again would be a great opportunity to try and see all of you here, but more on that through emails and other media. All right, with that, we'll close it here. Thank you all and see you next month.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, Vishal.
Thank you.